It was in October of 1945 that I got my discharge. I was now 37. Military service can be a traumatic experience. Such a sudden, complete change of every facet of any two people's lives, combined with a 2.5 year separation, can be hard on any marriage. I realized that readjustments would not be easy. Luckily, just before I was drafted, Stella and I had bought a little house in East San Diego. It was on a 2-acre lot and cost us $3,250, by the way. So, at least I had a familiar home to come to. I met some of Stella's friends that she had made during my absence. It didn't occur to me until later that most of them were men. Boots was now a young lady, dating all the boys. I didn't plan to go back to Consolidated. There was a ruling at that time that defense industries had to take back veterans who were their employees to their original jobs if they applied within 90 days of their discharge. But I had other ideas. Plastics were just coming into their own, and I figured that with the skills I had learned overseas, I should have an advantage in that business. An overseas buddy of mine was going in with me. Also, an ex-Navy chief, one of Stella's friends, had $5,000 which he had won in card games overseas, and he offered to contribute that for a share of the business. I made an appointment with a lawyer to draw up an agreement. The day before the appointment, the chief drew his $5,000 out of the bank. Next day, at the lawyer's office, he never showed. I found out later that he'd gotten into a card game. And before it was over, he'd lost the whole $5,000. So I called my buddy, told him it was all off. And on the 90th day after my discharge, at 4 p.m., I went in and asked for my job back. They put me back to work in the flight test department, building and installing instrumentation devices in new airplane designs. This big experimental flying boat for the Navy was one of many projects on which I worked. Literally hundreds of important measurements were photographed and recorded here on equipment which I helped to build. The B-36 was one of the largest bombers built. You could walk upright through the wing. This experimental Navy fighter crashed into San Diego Bay as I watched. The pilot was killed. While in India, I had conceived an idea for a new type drum pedal. I had built a crude model. When I got home, I improved on it. My device gave a beat on both the toe and the heel action. I applied for a patent, and eventually it was granted. I went back east and demonstrated the pedal to a big drum manufacturer. They were impressed and ordered 12 pedals for trial. They sent one to Buddy Rich, their sponsored drummer, for evaluation. The pedal required a new technique. He was dubious about changing his hard-won technique. So eventually, the whole thing died on the vine. Before giving up on the idea of being a backyard inventor, I patented another idea, an accelerator pedal for automobiles. On my pedal, as long as your foot was on it, it acted like any other accelerator pedal. But if you lifted your foot heel first, the pedal would remain at the same setting. When you put your foot back on it, you immediately had complete control again. At first, I had inquiries about it, but when the cruise control was finally invented, it did the job better, and companies were no longer interested. In 1948, we bought a pair of chinchillas. Chinchillas had just been introduced into this country and were bringing fabulous prices. In 1 year, the folks we bought them from shipped over $1 million worth out of San Diego by air. But things began happening in my life which prevented me from bringing the chinchillas home. I was finding whiskey bottles hidden around the house, and a couple of remarks that Boots, the daughter, made alerted me to some real nasty possibilities. I began to notice some odd conversations on the phone, and I became at first uneasy and finally suspicious. One day at work, I wasn't feeling well and went home early. When I got home, there was a car in my driveway. I recognized it as belonging to one of those friends of Stella's whom I mentioned before. I decided that if what I suspected was true, I should have a witness. I saw the man next door and asked him to come over. The doors were locked, but I broke in and found them, as I suspected, in bed together. There was a bad few minutes, of course, and some bad times later, but with an eyewitness ready to testify, I had no problems at all getting a divorce. All I wanted at this point was to get her out of my life. So the lawyers worked out a property settlement whereby she got the house and I got the car, the house trailer, the chinchillas, and so forth. I heard later that she had sold the house, moved out of town, and had died, presumably from her drinking. It was 1949 now. I was 41. I moved the house trailer to a trailer court and lived a rather unhappy and lonesome single life for a while. Do you remember we met this little gal earlier? The one who contracted polio when she was a year and a half old? Well, one night I met her. She was an attractive, intelligent gal with a wonderful personality. She was working as a secretary. She wore braces from the polio, but got around surprisingly well. She drove her own car and had not let her disability keep her from living a full life. The icy streets of Minnesota had been a hazard, so after her mother died, she came to California with two girlfriends. I liked her immediately, and we began to see a lot of each other. As you can imagine, I was married shy. I'd done a pretty poor job picking women to marry. I had a year to think about it before my divorce was final, and then, with considerable trepidation, I finally decided to try marriage one more time. Adelaide's father came out from St. Paul to give her away. Her brother and a lifelong girlfriend also came. My mother and father came from Cheyenne. The ceremony was performed at the Unitarian Church in San Diego. A friend of Adelaide's, Evelyn Swennis, and her daughter Marlene provided music. If I were writing captions for this picture, they would be, "What have I done now?" And, "I've made it." The wedding party consisted of Jack Swennis and Adelaide's brother Kenneth, ushers, best man Bill Gregory, my mother and father, Adelaide's father, Jim Enkel, and her lifelong friend, Kay Hansen, and my niece, Sharon Porter. We went to Catalina Island on our honeymoon. As it turned out, I need not have worried about this marriage. It was the smartest thing I ever did. We were very happy. We rented a little house in East San Diego. Adelaide, who was an accomplished musician, began teaching piano. I made her a gold leaf sign. The landlord kept raising our rent, so we decided to try to buy a place. With a war in Korea, housing was scarce. But finally, we stood in line to buy one of these in National City, a suburb of San Diego. All they could show us was a plot and a plan. We paid a high price, $9,500, for a two-bedroom house. We watched the progress of the construction day by day. Eventually, moving day arrived. Our furniture consisted of a stove, refrigerator, bed, a card table, and a grand piano. After we were settled, I talked the neighbors into building a cement block wall on all three sides. Adelaide was the cheapest help available. I got the neighbors to help pour a sidewalk. I bought an old Model A truck, called it Hortense. I decided I needed to build a shop and a place to keep the chinchillas. I did all the work myself, with a little help and supervision from the boss. Over the next couple of years, I did a lot of brick and rock work and other landscaping, and the yard began to look pretty nice. We finally got everything pretty well organized, and we're quite happy and pleased with ourselves. We replaced the apple boxes and card tables with furniture, and Adelaide soon had a nice class of piano pupils. We finally got the chinchillas home. Under our care, they multiplied rapidly, but it required a lot of our time and energy. Finally, I had about a dozen nice skins toward a cape for Adelaide, and then the bugs got into them and chewed them all up. We got discouraged, and a year or two later, sold all the animals. In 1954, Consolidated promoted me to assistant foreman. I decided I should get a college degree. I was accepted at San Diego State. I attended part-time and worked almost 5 years toward an engineering degree. I was working day and night. It was affecting my health and was really not fair to Adelaide. So eventually I was forced to give it up. But in the meantime, with a shortage of engineers and my record, I was promoted to engineer anyway. In 1955, we decided to invest in a rental. We bought these 4 units and later bought the big house next to them. Later still, we bought 3 more units. Convair, as it was called now, was still heavily into unusual projects. This was a vertical takeoff fighter, which we nicknamed the Pogo Stick. In 1957, we went to Cheyenne for my folks' 50th anniversary. I rented a movie camera, and of course, had to have a shot of my brother in his music store. The camera worked all right, but the framing was off, as you've probably noticed. I also carried a tape recorder all the way to Cheyenne to record the affair. And then, as you might know, I forgot to push the record button. My brother Kenneth and his family were there, of course, and my older sister Marie and her family came up from Texas. My younger sister Helen couldn't make it. By the time we got home, I was hooked on movies. I got interested in snails and began photographing their life cycle. In 1959, at the age of 51, I received my 15-year pin at Convair. That year, I was transferred to the Astronautics Division. Luckily, it was also located in San Diego. I was made an instrumentation planner on the Atlas missile, and later on the Centaur rocket. In 1960, we made several sad trips to Cheyenne. Dad got the Asian flu and died in February, and we brought Mother back to live with us. Adelaide took care of her for 6 months. Alzheimer's disease had ruined a very sharp, brilliant mind. Eventually, the poor soul began to think that I was her husband, and that Adelaide was stealing me away. When it got to where she would fight Adelaide, we had to take her back to Cheyenne to my brother and his wife. She died that November. We had begun to think about a better house. We found this 2-acre lot in Poway, a few miles north of San Diego, and finally bought it. I drew plans and even made a scale model of the house and lot, with the house where we thought it should be. My movie hobby proved to be quite rewarding. I finished the film on snails, and word got around, and I sold several copies to schools. I made a little comedy about an accident with aerosol shaving cans and won many awards. In 1965, my film on the life cycle of a butterfly was chosen as one of the 10 best in the International Photographic Society of America competition. We decided to go to the National Convention in Denver to accept my award. I had devised my own special system for recording lip sync sound using a flashlight bulb and bicycle horn. It worked, but the horn caused quite a lot of confusion.
Miss, see, okay, Sid. Now we have an award coming up. It's known as the MPD Nature Film Award. The winner is, beep, beep. Sid, front and center, please. He has an automated camera, do you hear it? Congratulations, Sid. You got enough pockets?
I'll go down with you and help you catch.
Congratulations.
How about hardware?
Over the next few years, I made several films. They were all made for the fun of it, but some copies were sold to schools and universities and elsewhere. I spent a lot of time and effort on them. A couple of them took as long as 4 years to complete. They won a lot of awards, and the walls in my studio began to be pretty crowded with trophies. I collected trophies from many different countries. Japan, Australia, South Africa, New Zealand. I also made some commercial films for pay. With Ernie Snyder, a good friend, we made a documentary on the building of a large ship for the National Steel and Shipbuilding Company. I also made a promotional film for the Langley Corporation and a commercial for Porter Shop. In 1966, I had worked 23 years at Convair. Suddenly, with no notice, I was laid off. That was a shocker we weren't prepared for. I immediately sent out resumes, but nobody was hiring 58-year-old men. 4 traumatic months went by while I considered other lower-paying jobs. Then, one day, the Hughes Tool Company in Culver City got a contract to build helicopters. Luckily, 2 friends of mine worked there and recommended me. I was hired as a flight test instrumentation engineer. Because we owned our home and income property in San Diego, it wasn't practical for us to move to the Los Angeles area. We had read about a man in Hemet, California, who had designed what he called a house car. It was really the first RV, recreational vehicle. We went up to Hemet to see it and ended up ordering one. The demand was so great that we had to wait about a month for delivery. We got one of the first ones off the line, but within a year, there were hundreds. The man eventually sold the business for $2 million. And with other companies starting up, there were soon thousands of RVs on the road. We called ours the Beast, and it surely worked out well for me. I would drive it the 130 miles to Culver City late Sunday night, park it in the company lot, set the alarm clock, and sleep till time to go to work. After work, I would drive it to a rented space in a trailer park. I'd drive to work each day, and Friday night, I'd head on down the freeway for San Diego. I built an electric actuated step so Adelaide could get in and out, and I made other improvements as time went on. When vacation time came, we would take off to see the country. We had a pet parakeet named Bozo, who we always took with us. The vehicle was very well made, and with all the conveniences, it proved to be an ideal way for Adelaide and I to travel. I drove most of the time, but once in a while, Adelaide would drive. Bozo just played with his toys and had a ball. Once in a while, Adelaide would take a little vacation from her piano class and from the hassle of trying to keep our tenants happy, and she'd come up and would stay with me for a week. Then once, our friends Vic and Ruth Brown came up and visited. I cooked steak. It really wasn't that tough. In 1965, when we had gone to the Denver PSA convention with our friend Phil Rapp, we had stopped at Durango, Colorado, and taken the ride on the famous narrow gauge steam train. I had shot some footage, but didn't have enough for a film. When I finally got a week's vacation from Hughes, we took a trip back in the Beast to shoot enough to finish the film. We spent 4 hard-working days filming. I even hired an airplane to get some spectacular air shots. And we went back and forth several times between Durango and Silverton. When I finished the film, about a year later, I called it A Trip to Yesterday. Back at Hughes, we were preparing for a wind tunnel test of a new high-speed helicopter design. The Ames Research Center in San Jose, California, has what I believe is the largest wind tunnel in the world. The throat is large enough to take a full-sized fighter plane, and the tremendous motors and propellers can generate airspeeds of 200 miles per hour or so. I designed instrumentation for the test. This was the control console. The helicopter could actually be run in the tunnel under tethered flight conditions. Hundreds of measurements of temperature, strain, pressures, and other parameters were measured and recorded. Operation of the engine and equipment were controlled and monitored at this panel. A remotely controlled TV camera in the tunnel allowed us to watch the test article visually. In 1971, after 5 years of commuting back and forth to Culver City, there was a lull in the helicopter business, and Hughes laid me off. I was 63 and decided to retire. Oh, yes, another important thing that happened that year. After 50 years of smoking, I quit cold turkey. We finally decided that building on our lot in Poway was not practical, so we sold it at a nice profit. One day I was driving by and noticed a for sale sign on this attractive house in Bonita. Bonita is a semi-rural area southeast of San Diego. The house was on a half-acre lot, all level, which was better for Adelaide, and when I saw the nice big room for a studio, we bought it. The inside walls were all painted an icky dark green, so we repainted everything. I'd spent a lot of money, so I used the cheapest help available. She also did windows. But her forte seemed to be supervision. The kitchen was a mess, one small light bulb, and there were no windows. I raised the counter and sink an inch or two and retiled it. This made room for a dishwasher. To solve the lighting problem, I installed a ceiling of light. We installed a new stove. We had a nice refrigerator, but I had to rebuild most of the shelving to make it fit. I built all new drawers with roller-bearing hardware so Adelaide could operate them easily. We also installed central air conditioning. By now, I had become fairly active in the movie club.
First, I'm very happy to be the new president of the San Diego Amateur Movie Club. It's a great honor, I think.
The club treasury was low, and I got the idea of putting on a one-man film show. It was quite a success. We made around $1,000. We bought loudspeakers and other equipment for our clubhouse. In 1976, after falling several times, Adelaide finally gave in and started to use a walker. In addition to the problems caused by the polio, arthritis was now restricting her movements more and more each year. By the 1980s, a wheelchair became necessary. In 1976, someone dumped off a little long-haired dachshund by our house. I got sorry for her and fed her. We asked around and advertised, but got no results, and she was soon part of the family. I made up a little song and taught her to sing.
Okay, I sing the verse, you come in on the chorus.
One day in 1979, I saw an article in the Reader's Digest. Remembering the test results back at the sheet metal school, I got curious and took the Mensa tests. Sometime later, I got back the results. They said that the tests showed my IQ in the top 2% of the population and that I was accepted into Mensa. Well, let's take 90 seconds and recap the changes that take place in the face over 78 years.